Well, welcome back into the House of Mystery. I'm Al Warren. Mr. Joe Goldberg is in the house today. And we've got one of the best with us today.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and he's got a new book, a legal thriller, and it's called Suspicious Activity. So we're thrilled to have him. And we've got Mike Papantonio. Thank you for being here.
Well, thanks for the invitation, Alan. I appreciate it.
Mike. So listen, just so people know, you are a kind of a all over the place, and you're a lawyer and you've got a legal firm. And the reason I mention that is because that obviously has a big influence on your writing.
Yeah, every book, this is, I think, the sixth book that's been written. They've all been based on cases. Fortunately, the cases that we handle are, you know, they're everything from the tobacco litigation to the opioid litigation to human trafficking to PFAS, you know, 80 of the biggest pharmaceutical cases that have ever been tried in the country. Those originated with us. So it gives me a lot of material to write with, needless to say. It's kind of automatic pilot because as the case is taking place, you're able to do chapter by chapter according to where the moves take place. Yeah.
Yeah. How do you decide which you're going to base it on? Like, is there a particular reason you pick a certain case? Is it the way it made you feel or something important about it?
Yeah, well, the only cases I handle are those types of cases. They're kind of the broader complex cases. But there's always the way I evaluate a case, for example, the same way I evaluate what I want to write about with the book, is it's hard to evaluate a case until you see the documents, until you understand what the conduct has been, until you see the emails, until you see all the awful things that have been written when people were writing during time they never thought it would be discovered. And so once I dig into that, it tells a great story. I mean, the opioid case, for example, or the inhuman trafficking was the last book I came out with, and that was a book based on the whole trafficking scenario. Who's in charge? We found out Wall Street was involved in a lot of it. And so that kind of screamed out for, this is a good basis for a case. This is a good basis not only for a case but for a book. And so you just write around that. The case book I'm working on right now is on a litigation dealing with the big insulin fraud. And so – but every time I write, I look at – what are the facts? How bad was the conduct? How bad were these players? And if this were a nonfiction, would it still have appeal? And so I find fiction is an easier way to get people to pay attention. It's an amazing thing. But, you know, somebody will take a book like, hopefully Suspicious Activity, sit on a beach and read about it and understand what suspicious activity in the banking business means and understand the connection between terrorism and banks washing money for terrorism or drug cartels. It's not something you see in everyday media. And I've been in the media business a lot of years, Alan, and most stories stay alive. If they stay alive 48 hours, that's amazing. But when you put it to a fiction book, they come away, and hopefully you've told a good story. And in that story, they've learned, gee, I never knew that HSBC made $100 billion washing money for drug cartels and terrorists. And I never knew that the way they were punished was to make them pay a billion-dollar fine when people should have gone to prison. They don't know those stories. And corporate media is very, very poor as far as telling those stories. And so if it doesn't come out in a documentary, a movie, or a book, it's tough to perpetuate that story beyond 48-hour span, you know?
Right.
Well, you have a established lawyer character, Deke. Does that mean?
Nick Deketomis.
Yeah, I can't do his last name. If I tried that, I'd butcher it up like Papantonio. Yeah. But you're looking for stories. You're in trials. You have these events and, you know, stories come to you. Are you thinking then, how do I put Deke inside that story? Or is the story happen then you say, I have my character. How do I fit that story to build my character out?
If Deke doesn't fit in, I don't write the story. If it's not something that it's credible and believable that this is something Deke would do, then I don't put him in. I don't put the team in. It's a pretty close-knit team of legal operators of all types. Everybody from Michael Carey, who was a ex-pararescue man, special ops guy that became an attorney with a firm, and or Carol Morris, who is an extraordinary investigator, or the paralegal team. They all fit. If they fit the story, then I'm comfortable writing. I'm comfortable putting Deke in that setting. I'd never put Deke in a case with transactional law or divorce law or maybe even criminal law. I don't know that I'd put him in the middle of a criminal case because he doesn't fit quite nicely there. You know what I mean? But in the stories that he fits, like this one, he was a perfect fit, and so it just made sense to write it.
So the lawyers and the characters inside your book are people or characterizations of people that you know have come across within your career?
Well, they do. They're all composites. Actually, Deke is a composite. He's a composite of a couple of really extraordinary trial attorneys that I've worked with and against over the years. Everybody in the book, Carol Morris was drawn on an investigator that actually works for this firm and has for almost 40 years. The paralegal team, these are actually people that I work around. Change the names. You know, I change the names and I give them a different description. But they're people that are real. I mean, they actually do these things. For example, the story in Suspicious Activity, it's a true story. I mean, we really do represent these folks that have been killed and they've lost limbs, arms, legs, and they've lost their mothers and their brothers and sisters because of the conduct of European and American banks washing money for terrorism. So those are tangible things, and it's easy to write around those tangible ideas. You know, I can come out of court and I can have a hearing and I'll say, you know, that judge really nailed it. And let me talk about it. Let me give the public a look at what it looks like behind those curtains. Because you don't really see those curtains on run-of-the-mill television. You know, I'm a big, huge Billy Bob Thornton fan, and I liked Goliath, for example. But there's no way a lawyer could look at Goliath and say, yeah, that was accurate. So right. I tried to bring a little more realism to it, and it is realism. There's nothing in there where you would say, well, that just never would happen. If I finish a chapter and I think it's not credible, I'll rewrite, you know.
Well, that leads me to sort of a two-part question. It's just, what is it about the legal genre in books that keeps people coming back? I mean, there's so much law out there, and we've been reading these for, you know, Perry Mason, the old real Perry Mason, and beyond. So what is it about the legal thing that, want to come back to?
I've thought about that a lot. I think there's two things. Part of it, there's that voyeur aspect. Why is it they like medicine? Why do they want to see the doctors? Why do they want to see the stories about medicine? But the other thing they're looking for is some element of justice. They're looking at some equilibrium. You know, if we believe the world's always trying to find equilibrium, there's that going on with them. They're thinking, God, you know, why can't I see justice? So you take them through a story that's set up, it's these stories being true, it makes it even more compelling because the endings are, you know, they don't necessarily end with the kind of tragedies or the excitement that I end my books with, but they end in a way that the American consumer walks away and says, God, at last, you know, at last we dealt with the politics and we dealt with regulators and we dealt with the money in politics and the lobbyists and we dealt with all these damn problems that we're confronted with, that there's no justice in this world. And I think people read these because in a legal thriller, you're able to take them through that and you're able to say there is justice. And let me tell you a story. Let me tell you the story about justice. And it gives them a little bit of victory, you know, the sense that even if they're reading a book, they know it can be done. You know, we're living in a world that is so out of balance where it comes to the American consumer or the average person having any chance to stand up to power. And these books allow them to do that because as you take them page through page, you're taking them through, first of all, the turmoil, the threat. You're taking them through the danger of what they're confronted with. And then they're fighting back. You know, there's chapters where, my God, you know, the good guy's kicking somebody's butt. And I like that. And then you're taking them through the doubt where okay, they kicked a butt in this chapter, but things went wrong here. It's life that they're living through the book. And the resolution is to always leave them on a high note to where, good God, life is hard enough without reading a book and you go, what the hell just happened? You know, I don't like this ending. You take them through, there's a resolution where things work out for the average person.
Well, let's stay with that. You have the legal book, you have these events happening and people responding to them. Yeah, we know a lot of lawyers. Like, we know Perry Mason, we know Atticus Finch, we know Matlock. I mean, take your pick. And lawyers and books, the Grisham books, all that. How does your lawyer, how do you keep him fresh? What is there something about another, it's another lawyer. How do you keep it from
he's kind
another lawyer book?
Right. I try to, you know, first of all, they're lawyers that are damaged goods. As a matter of fact, Gina Romano is a character that I have show up in the book. I mean, she's an incredible trial lawyer. Female trial lawyer who's just worked terribly hard to get where she is. And in there, she's really damaged goods. She comes from a childhood that's dysfunctional. There's not you wouldn't want to marry the woman, maybe have a few drinks with her or something like that, but she's just an incredible advocate. She's who you want on your side. And so I think you have to be honest about that. You know, there are lawyers out there that do really bad things. I have a show called America's Lawyer, and for years I've been talking about, you know, why doesn't a lawyer use his license, his or her license, for something besides 1-800 car crash? They have the same license that everybody else has. Why don't they say, I can use this license to clean up an ecosystem? I can use it to get bad drugs off the market. So there, but they don't. You know, there's no hero that's not tarnished somewhat. And so I don't try to make Deke, for example, into a, you know, an untouchable hero. He's an interesting man. He's you know, somebody that you'd want to call your best friend. But even in that, he has his issues. You know, he has hubris. He's got all types of issues that have to be dealt with, and they surface in the book because there's no way that a reader is going to accept an Atticus Finch. I wrote a book one time called In Search of Atticus Finch. That was actually the title of the book. Yeah. And so in that book, I was trying to understand what makes him so different. Well, he was a creation. And are they out there? Yeah. Do I see them that often? No, I don't. But they're there, you know.
So who is Deke to you, and what kind of relationship do you have with them? And I mean that in the sense of, do you hear them? Do you see them when you do dialogue? Is
for,
it like a
for
movie?
For sure. I built a lot of Deke around my life. You know, Deke was raised, you know, he's raised by their families. That's how I was raised. He came up kind of rough. I did too. There's things I can relate to about Deke that make it legitimate when you see Deke angry. What is it that drives anger with Deke? What is it? Why does he have this sense of compassion for other people? Well, it's his life experience, you know? And so you have to draw some of that. So I take a little bit of myself. I take a little bit of other lawyers that I understand really well. When they do things that I don't agree with, I understand, okay, I don't agree with that, but I understand why you're doing it. Or where they do really extraordinary things, and I look at them and I say, wow, that's what we all should be. So I do understand him really well. I understand when he's going to be, what setting he should be in, when he's going to react, how he should react, because I feel that everything I write.
And so each one of these books, and this one as well, it seems like it's a major topic, a major event or thing that you want to see corrected, to see have a better outcome. So when you live through the case, as well as write it in the book, how do you think that changes you at the end of each book?
Well, I it's always a reminder, and the reminder is this. The reminder is that, you know, we can't, for example, when I finished writing in Human Trafficking, or when I finished the first part of the case, or opioid, let's take the opioid problem that we had, killing 150 people a day in America, and I was taking the depositions, the key depositions that were used in that case to bring settlement, to, you know, to make them come to the table and settle. So as I was doing that, I was thinking that, that you know what? I'm not going to solve this forever. I remember sitting across to one of the truly sociopaths that was making these decisions with one of the major companies. And I recognized that I'm really across the table from a sociopath. But I realized that all I can do is I can deal with this case while I'm alive and kicking. I can try to make it better while I'm alive and kicking. And I've been able to come to terms with I can't fix it forever. I can write about it and hopefully, you know, maybe get to where people remember it. But I can't fix it forever. I can just do what I can do as I'm passing through. And so writing these books allows me to do more than that. It allows me to reassert this happened. You should know about it and be aware of it, you know.
And your female character, how do you get into the head of a female character in a lawyer like that? What's your kind of influence or inspiration on writing that character?
Well, I think if any female character that I have in the book, whether it's a paralegal, investigator, a lawyer, I've always had a theory. And the theory is you can't really do what we do without being able to call on genuine anger, okay? In other words, there is no, when I use the term sociopath, you can't compromise with sociopaths. And I don't use that loosely. I, honest to God, I do not. I mean, if you look at every case that I've ever handled, every book that I've ever written about the case that I handled, on the other side of it was somebody that on a DSM-5, you could check mark, you know, check, check, check. They've got all these qualities. You can't deal with that person with a normal sense of the world. You have to be able to call on real, genuine outrage and anger. So in a female, I'm looking for that. I'm looking for a Carol Morris that, you know, or a Gina Romano who can go from 0 to 100 because somebody has been mistreated or somebody's done something wrong. Those are the females that I have interest in. I'm not interested in, from a female character, I'm not interested in a compromiser. I'm not interested in let's sing kumbaya. I'm interested in an attack individual that knows how to attack and knows how to use that anger in a very positive way. So that's the feature that you'll find in most of the women that I write about.
Yeah, it's interesting. So now what do you hope someone takes away from the book besides the action and entertainment part of it?
Well, I hope that a couple of things. I mean, several things. First of all, that the cavalry ain't coming. Okay, we grow up with this notion that you know the wagons are turned over, the bullets are flying, the pioneers they're out of food, they're out of ammunition, the kids are screaming, the women are running for cover, and then it looks like it's all over, and all of a sudden, over the hill comes the cavalry. Okay, that's what we've been taught. That's what we think.
That's not coming?
The cavalry is not coming. Cavalry's not coming. And so what I want them to take away is the cavalry's not coming, that you have to do something about what's happening around you. You know, you got to take the time and you have to understand it first of all. You don't get it from headlines. You can't read the, you know, LA Times and walk away understanding what the backstory is or you have to dig in to understand how did the opioid event take place? Why did we allow banks to wash money for terrorists? Why do we still allow it? How did that happen? How does the bank work through all that to where at the end of the day they've killed thousands and thousands of people? They've participated in that. As a matter of fact, in the HSBC case, they actually signed a document saying, yes, we did that. We know we did that. And there was nobody went to prison, okay? So I want them to ask, why did nobody go to prison? Why have we treated these white-collar criminals so differently than we have the child out on the street corner selling 3 ounces of marijuana who may go to, you know, prison for life if he's done it 3 times? Why is that? I want them thinking about that. And I put those like little you know, little moments in the book. I don't dwell on it. The books aren't preachy. I don't think you'll ever read a book and say, let me take it back. Law and Disorder was preachy. It was my first book, and I thought it was preachy. But then I understood that you don't really need to preach it. You simply tell this story in a way that's compelling, and you hope that they're going to grasp what you're saying. A, the Department of Justice was useless and is useless where it comes to dealing with white-collar crime, that we treat people differently. There are no regulators out there looking over the shoulder to find out if banks are washing money that's resulting in American deaths. There are no politicians that are taking this on as their prime concern because the money from the other side is too big. Those are things that we don't talk about. You know, corporate media doesn't deliver those kinds of ideas. It's headline stuff. It's all we see. And so hopefully you look behind, you read a chapter and you think about that chapter and you've heard some of the things I'm talking about, that there was no regulation or the regulators were commandeered by the industry. They were commandeered by the banks and they actually ended up working for the banks, not for consumers. But that's not stuff we think about every day, is it?
Well, let's stick with that one. So you definitely have a themes to your book beyond the case, beyond the fact that it's human trafficking or opioids or we should talk about the current book, you know, IEDs and the like. So I see a theme. Are you trying to is there a sense of that you want to bring awareness in addition to maybe a little bit of a call to action inside that theme?
I want to, but I don't want to preach. And that's a difficult thing sometimes because, you know, when you have a lot of stuff that you know about, you're everyday living the backstories and you're saying, Jesus Christ, I want somebody to understand how bad it really is. That you know, the court system is not always fair, or that the court system, we have these misconceived notions about, you know, what makes a good judge or what political party is going to appoint the best judges or all this stuff we think we know and we believe that are, you know, hugely tribal in nature. You know, if you think about it, a lot of stuff's just tribal in nature. You're D or you're an R and you have these beliefs. And these books, I hope, work through that and just say, bullshit. You know, whatever you're thinking, bullshit. Rethink it. And make yourself aware of what's really going on around you, because it's dangerous not to.
Well, then, does it? I don't want to say worry you, but does it make you cautious when you're kind of covering these major events going on in today's world? Because now it's so divisive and it's so, everyone's so nasty out there, right? There's a lot of conspiracies and a lot of name calling and stuff. Do you? And then you not only take the case on, but then you write a book about it.
I mean, I probably, you know, corporate America, I'm not their favorite. Matter of fact, I've actually found emails and memos and that type of thing and talking about how I approach a case, how I approach depositions, what to do to put me down, what to do to have the judge, you know, get me knocked out of the case. There's all kinds of stuff that goes on like that. They don't like the books. I can tell you that. They don't like the books. And I mean, I'm talking about major corporations. I'm talking about DuPont, Pfizer, Merck, name it. I mean, Goldman, just name it. And I've probably mixed it up with them. So there are only a handful of lawyers in the country that do what I do. And so I think it gives me an opportunity to write a book that would be very difficult for most lawyers to write. It really would be. And so in there, it also gives me, as you point out, a little bit of a target on my back. You know, the opioid case, they made every move they could to get me, you know, kicked out of that case for attacking the Sackler family, you know. And so that's part of their strategy. How do we get this guy out of the picture? And so they really do hate when I come out of that and I write a book about them. They know who it is. When I talk, you know, the law firm in suspicious activity, I have, you know, a different name for them, but everybody's going to know who that is, you know? So everybody in the legal business, at least.
Yeah.
So.
Well, that's my question. You're a real life events, real companies, real people. How sensitive are you for the, you know, the libel, defamation, real life taking facts and putting in the fiction world.
I'd be delighted to have them sue me, you know, because it allows me to take their to take their cross examination and depositions, and I get to find out the story behind the story even in more depth. Yeah, I don't really worry about that. I'm extra careful on how I do that and write it. And there's nothing in there that's represented that is not true, you see. The bankers that read this, my God, they're going to be so pissed. But, you know, they know it goes on. Suspicious activity reports, SARs, they understand what that's about. They understand how they game the system. They understand how they're willing to put in this particular, or drug cartels, they understand what they're doing to further the success of the drug cartels in the United States. They know exactly what they're doing. But it's an economic decision they make. And so am I afraid to talk about it? Of course not. Not at all. And they would have better sense than to sue me. I mean, if they sue me, what ends up happening is it opens a case. It really opens the case. I mean, it really opens the case. And some of the material I couldn't even get to becomes available.
Right, I'd imagine like you say, there's a lot of people in the country that don't necessarily feel there's very good justice, right? And you look at what's going on, even with the last president and all the turmoil in that. There's a lot of people that don't believe justice will ever really it never really takes place. Do you actually change the endings or change some of the things in the book to make it so that there is justice?
Yeah, I don't know. Actually, the books always end. And I'm trying to think of that. As you were asking that question, I kind of thought where you were going. Yeah, I don't think I've ever written a book where I've had to take the result and make it better. For example, the opioid case, I was successful with that. Tobacco, there was success. Human trafficking, partial success. This case, suspicious activity, gets the closest to what you're saying, because on suspicious activity, the case against the banks up in the Southern District of New York has been dismissed, and it's up on appeal right now. So I had to anticipate where I thought it was going to go, and I had to end it with the idea that a law firm can go after these banks under a law that's called JASTA, J-A-S-T-A, which is a broad law that's there to protect, as it's called, the justice against sponsors of terrorism. It was written by our legislators after 9/11. And so it's there to protect people from this very thing. But the idiots that have looked at it, the judges that have looked at it, haven't had enough sense to apply JASTA. So we're having to take it up on appeal to do that. Wow. So, but I end this book with what I believe is the resolution is going to be, and that is success. I mean, how do you protect a bank? How do you say that the very legislation, JASTA, the very title, Justice Against Sponsors of Terrorism, how do you say that does not have application to a bank who knowingly and admittedly signed a massive document saying, yes, we did that. Yes, we agreed that it resulted in deaths of American soldiers and contractors. Yes, we made a gazillion dollars doing it. Yeah, we did all that. But the bank that does it doesn't fall within JASTA? So that's what's up on appeal right now.
Wow. That's interesting.
I'm intrigued. Thank you. Off I go. Add it to the pile.
Wow. And where do you draw the line with your, let's say, the victims or the people that you're writing about, the cases and stuff? How much of their truth or their feelings and stuff can you expose in a book that's still kind of fictional at the same time? How do you draw that?
People want their stories told, you know, especially when it's somebody else's name. They'll know the story. If you, Law and Addiction is a great example. Law and Addiction, those are real people. I mean, those are real people. The way the case came to me, the way it was developed, All of that really happened. But as you're reading it, you're reading a story and you're going, hell, I don't know whether this happened or not, but it's a good story. But the people that were involved along the line, they like to go back and read and say, hell, that's me. You know, I'm Paul in this book. I did this, you know, or I'm Andy in this book. I did this. And so there's some victory to them even in that, you know, even the people who were terribly victimized, the human trafficking case, inhuman trafficking, as I say, is my last book. And I think the people who read that, there was a lot of movement came out of that book, actually, a lot of movement. It was something that has motivated lawyers all over the country to get involved in human trafficking. They see that there's a way to do it. They see the money goes all the way to Wall Street. You're not just going after some thug who is trafficking two or three girls. You're talking about a design where, you know, trafficking's taking place and Wall Street money's behind it. And so it's kind of thing to where in a series of events that take place out of these books, I'm able to actually make lawyers pay attention and say, you know, I've got a license. I worked hard for the license. It's not an easy thing to have, but why in the hell am I using it on 1-800 workers' compensation when I can be solving the problems for thousands of people all over the country? That's something that lifts them up a little bit. And so I guess to some degree, I write the book for that purpose too, to say, pay attention, man. You know, you don't have to be just the average Joe out there running after auto cases. Do something meaningful with your practice, you know? And so these books certainly have accomplished that, absolutely, positively have accomplished that.
Well, you ate in to my next question, so I'll go with it anyway. Actually, my next two questions. But when Mike writes, and who's over your shoulder? Is it the lawyer market for you? Is it the non-lawyer reader market? Who is your target market?
Yeah, wow. No, it's a very good question because I think about it all the time. So let me answer it this way. If I were to spend too much time on technical jargon, when I find myself doing that, it's like a wake-up call for me. It's like something goes off in my head and say, who the hell are you writing for? You're writing this for lawyers. The person, they don't understand these machinations. They don't care about all this legal intricacy. They just want to know, did the ship come in? So you have to bring the ship in a way. And when I find myself in that corner, I'm saying, Pap, you're writing for lawyers now. That's for another day. Right now, write for people out there that might think that this is something that affects their lives. And so I'm always conscious of that. I know what I'm doing it. You know, it's just like a mad professor. I'll be up 3 o'clock in the morning turning out a chapter. I say, damn, that was good. I just nailed it. I go back and read it. And hell, you'd have to be a specialist in mass torts to understand it. So I scratch it and start again.
The last couple of books, at least, you've had a co-author. Can you tell me how align that process, how it works?
Yeah, I tried it with a co-author. Well, this book, this Chris Paulus, really wasn't a co-author. He's really more of an advisor. He's the lawyer in my firm that's handling the case, and I had such admiration for him. He was a technical advisor. He wasn't a writer. But I put him on the cover because I thought he deserved that. He spent hours saying, you know, schooling me up and correcting things that were wrong. With Alan on, I think it was Inhuman Trafficking, I met Alan and we just got along so well, and he's so much of a better writer than me. He truly is a professional. And I would talk to him and I'd say, well, Alan, what do you think about this idea, that idea? And I just finally said, well, just let's do this book together. I mean, the guy's an extraordinary writer. And that's the extent of it. You know, I think people are a little bit arrogant when they don't do this all the time. This isn't my day job. And it's like, because it's not, I've got to have people that can tell me, Pap, you've got all of this organized wrong. You know, this chapter that you wrote is in the wrong place. This, this idea that you have is just not coming through. And as I constantly, constantly am relying on that. You know, you have a lot of writers, as you know, moving to team writing right now. And I'm interested in watching that. I mean, you have some really good writers that say, let me tell a good story, but let me do it with a team. Let me have, like, for example, I don't have researchers. I have researchers in-house that work in the law firm, and they'll do most of the research for me. But I don't have professional writing researchers. I'm not to that point. I hope someday I am, to where I have something that's a better organization, a true writing organization that tells stories that are powerful. And I hope to be there sometime. I'm not there yet.
Wow. So now, setting and stuff, is setting important to you? Location?
You know, I probably don't spend enough time with it. When my wife reads something, she'll say, Mike, you know, you need to talk about what they're wearing and what they look like and what, you know, what's the venue. You know, the whole idea of you've heard forever, show me, don't tell me. I really believe that. I live by that. And so what I'll do, and I hope this isn't too weird, maybe, because I don't, you know, I don't talk to that.
You're not going to Alan, so forget it.
Okay.
Don't worry about it.
So what I'll do is I'll sit in a room, say a bar, okay, and I'll, you know, chandeliers here and, you know, beautiful statues over to my left and plants growing somewhere and beautiful wallpaper, whatever it is. And I'll write describing the room, okay? My first thought of it, if this is such an important scene, is to just write something and just describe the room and then try to figure out how the characters describe that room through their dialogue. I don't know if that's how other people do it. That's what I do because, again, I'm just not, you know, I'm reading Mark Cameron right now and I'm thinking, my God, what a great writer. I mean, this guy is Mark. So damn good. And I go, well, I can't, I'm not there yet. I think I'm writing well enough to people would want to read the books. I think they're good books, don't get me wrong. But I'm not at the point where I could do that as easily as he does it. So what I would do is start off and I would do a predicate to say, let me describe the room first. What's interesting about this room? And now let me figure out how the character is telling me about that chandelier or the wallpaper. How am I moving into show me, don't tell me, you see? And I think the more you do it, a Cameron kind of guy just does it, you know, he just boom. And I do that somewhat, probably half the time, maybe three quarters of the time I'm able to do that. But the setting is important to the sense that it's gonna drive the dialogue in a lot of ways, you know.
Right, right. It's crazy. And what about the violence, sex, graphics, and stuff like that? It's a thrill.
Yeah. If you read through, yeah. Oh no. Matter of fact, this last book that I'm just now finishing, I've been in an argument with a couple of people about the violence in it. It's probably the most violent ending I've ever put in a book. But it was necessary. It's the kind of thing when you read it, you go, you know, people reading it will hate the people so badly that I'm having to beat around and do awful things to. They'll hate those people so bad that it'll be a victory for them. Gratuitous violence, I don't use. Gratuitous cussing, I don't use. In the book, I don't throw F-bombs around unless it's going to really make a difference. I never use GD in a book. It's just, you know, call it what you want. It's just how you're raised. It's just how I'm raised, man. And so I feel there's certain things I won't do. But violence, I think violence, you have to have violence sometimes as a vehicle to make the reader feel victory. Isn't that awful? But it's the truth. You know, the bad guys really, no, they really got it in this one. So, yeah, I do put that there. You'll find that all through books.
Yeah. Well, that's good. I mean, that's important, you know, and it keeps it moving as well, right?
Yeah.
And you feel justice and stuff. So,
for sure.
And so now you're working on something else already. So you just
yeah. Well, as a matter of fact, I'm almost finished with it. It's like another case we're handling. We're handling the case against the insulin industry, pharmaceutical industry that's price gouging insulin, and people are dying because they're having to take half you know, half the what they should be taking so they can save money. It's just the most corrupt industry ever, where we've got a pharmaceutical industry that's, you know, 4,000% markup is not uncommon. And you just go, God, you know, at what point do you just say it's got to stop? And insulin tells the story really well. And so I'm using that as the centerpiece for what I think is a very, very good book. And a matter of fact, I'm just finishing it up right now. So
that's great. Sounds great. Okay, listen, do you do social media, website? Where do people find?
Yeah, I do. I don't, Mike Papantonio is not something that is a really go-to. Actually, Ring of Fire is something I started. Bobby Kennedy and I started Ring of Fire, 35 years ago. And that's where I'm usually found, on Ring of Fire. And it's got more than a million, I think it's 1,100,000 followers and subscribers. And so Ring of Fire is that site, and that's where I'm usually found. But this book is available most places. I mean, it's going to be obviously Amazon and, you know, all the regular places I think you'd buy a book.
Right, of course. Well, and of course, we're going to have it up on our website as well.
Well, thank you. I really do appreciate that, Alan.
Of course. And the book we're talking about is Suspicious Activity. It's a legal thriller. And our guest that's been with us is the writer of that book. We've got Mike Papantonio. Thank you for being here.
Well, thank you, guys. I appreciate you inviting me. I hope I haven't said anything too out of line with what writers should say, but I'm, you know, I just think that the questions you've asked me have forced me to say what's on my mind. So
it's all good.
That it had helped dirty money flow through its branches around the world, including at least 800...
Plaintiffs allege that the defendants provided money and medical goods to terrorist groups Hezbollah and Jaish al-Mahdi.
This is a well-organized business for these individuals that carry out these attacks. Terrorism is a business, and they run it like a business.
They knew about what was going on for a decade. They absolutely, no question about it, knew that HSBC was washing money. They had every reason to understand it was for terrorism and it was for drug cartels. Took no action whatsoever.
These banks are involved. Their accounts are connected, and they're using them to mask the transactions. The more complicated they can make the transactions, the more distance they can put between the bad guys and the seemingly legitimate purpose of these funds.
They pay $1.9 billion, which is a drop in the bucket compared to what they've made, and nobody goes to prison. These CEOs, these bankers that made this decision, they're safe at home. They know what they've done. It's resulted in the death of Americans, contractors and soldiers, not just hundreds, but thousands. And we look the other way because they don't look like criminals. The die is cast. The people that are responsible are on Wall Street.
And they don't look like criminals. It's almost a suspension of disbelief. Sometimes I'll have people call me and say, is this real? Do they really get away with this? Yeah, they do.